Morning, everybody. We're going to get started. So we have two presenters this morning. The second one, who I'm not going to come back up and introduce, is Lloyd Williams. He's back there. He's going to show some pictures and share some stories from his recent trip to South Sudan. And the first presenter I wanted to introduce is Dr. Marielle Young. She recently gave a talk to the residents and invited us to call her Mimi. I don't know if that invitation is open to everyone or not, but she's shaking her head yes. She is one of our new faculty in the Pediatric Ophthalmology Division, and she is from here originally. She went to East High School and went to medical school here at the University of Utah, so some of you may know her. Completed her residency at UCSF and then recently completed her pediatric ophthalmology fellowship at the Children's Hospital of Boston. She's excited to be here. She's been seeing patients out at the Riverton Primary Children's location, and we look forward to her talk.
Thanks, Grant. I'm going to talk about ocular torsion today and how we diagnose and treat it. I did my fellowship at Children's Hospital Boston and did a lot of adults, so I do like seeing adults as well as children. And this talk kind of centers a little bit more on the adult strabismus part of my practice. So I'm kind of going to center my talk around a case. And this is a woman from fellowship, and this is a 61-year-old woman who came in complaining of different vision in both eyes. She didn't really describe it as double vision, but when you talked to her a little bit more, it was clear that that was what she was talking about, but just said she had a really hard time sometimes when she would move her eyes into different positions of gaze, and was really bothered by this, particularly with walking and looking down and going downstairs. This had come up since she had a motor vehicle accident 8 months prior. This was a pretty severe injury that, after which she wound up in a coma and was in the ICU for a couple of months. On exam in the clinic, she had really excellent vision in each eye and just minimal refractive error. Her pupil examination was normal. Her slit lamp exam just showed a little bit of cataract, and her dilated fundus exam was pretty unremarkable. Here's just a look at her ocular motility. You can see just briefly looking at it, it doesn't seem like there's anything grossly wrong. Just looking initially just at her straight ahead position, she actually looks pretty orthotropic here. I know many people get anxious when they see big pictures like this and have a hard time initially looking at them or breaking them down, but if you just look at her, start by looking at her horizontal gaze, you can see that when she looks to the right, perhaps maybe her left eye is just a little bit higher, so maybe she's got a little bit of inferior oblique overaction going on here, but pretty mild. And if you look this way, you can see that she has her left, when she looks into left gaze, her right eye is just a tiny bit higher, but maybe even a little bit less so. Also just breaking it down into her vertical gazes here, you can see when she looks down, she maybe has a little bit of esotropia. She looks up maybe a little bit less so, but these are pretty mild overall, nothing that really jumps at you. She also seems to have a little bit of a deviation in primary gaze, they can still be pretty debilitated by what they have in down gaze, because you do so many things in down gaze. You read in down gaze, you go up and down stairs in down gaze. So this is a really important thing to check, because it can really be difficult for people to deal with. You can also see that she has a right hypertrophy on right head tilt and a left hypertrophy on left head tilt. So just kind of breaking this down, we have a woman who has a V-pattern esotropia, what looks like on right gaze a left hypertropia, and on left gaze a right hypertropia. Any thoughts on what she could have? Any of the residents? Yeah, exactly. So in these patients who come in with a vertical deviation story like this, it's really important. A really important part of the puzzle is assessing their ocular torsion. Because even though they have a small amount of deviation, they can have quite a bit of ocular torsion that can be difficult for them to fuse. And we could do that a couple of different ways. In this woman, with double Maddox rod testing, she had about 12 degrees of excyclotorsion, which can be more than most people can fuse. Usually we can fuse up to about 8 degrees. And then another way we can assess it is anatomically, just looking at their fundus. And she had quite a bit of excyclotorsion, a little bit more in the right eye than the left eye, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. So I'm briefly going to talk about the anatomy of the eye and how it relates to ocular torsion, how we assess ocular torsion. Using the head tilt test, double Maddox rods, looking at the fundus. Conditions in which we see abnormal torsion, such as superior oblique palsy, skew deviation, and then briefly at the end about some surgical considerations. Come back to my case. So torsional strabismus is the abnormal rotation of the eye around the visual axis and is usually caused by the malfunction of the cyclovertical muscles. Like I said before, patients can usually compensate for about 8 degrees of excyclotorsion or in cyclotorsion either way. We more commonly see excyclotorsion than incyclotorsion, and as I said before, it's a very important part of the examination in any patients with vertical strabismus, even when they don't have torsional complaints, even when they don't say, I see one image and then I see another that's tilted. It's important to assess for it because it can be an important part of your management. It's caused by either the malfunction of cyclovertical muscles or by anatomic orbital pathology, such as in patients with craniosynostosis, where they really have excyclorotated orbits. Usually these patients don't really complain of it, but they can have findings on dilated exam. So just briefly to review, our superior muscles in toward the eye. So some people say the superior people are in the in crowd. So our superior rectus, superior obliques in toward, whereas our inferior muscles extort. The head tilt testing is an important part of the three-step test. And the three-step test is something we often see on OCAPs and boards and things like that. And I'm just going to explain a little bit about how that head tilt test works. So tilting your head simulates torsion. So when you tilt your head to the right, your right eye intorts to compensate. You have two muscles that are torsionally acting there. So your superior oblique and your superior rectus are both intorting your eye. These muscles also have vertical action. So while the superior oblique is intorting your eye, it's also pulling your eye down, whereas your superior rectus is intorting your eye and also pulling your eye up. In a normal eye, these are counterbalanced and key end. But in an eye that has a palsy, such as a superior oblique palsy, like in this patient here, you can see that the superior rectus is going to overwhelm and pull up harder than the palsied superior oblique is going to pull down. So when you're tilting this head when she's tilting her head to the right, she's going to have a right eye that's higher than her left eye. Whereas when she tilts her head the other way, those same torters are going to relax and going to let the right eye extort. So you can see that when she's tilting to the right, she's got a right hypertrophia, but when she tilts to the left, she looks pretty straight. The three-step test is an important test to identify an isolated acute vertical muscle weakness. So it doesn't really work in complex deviations, doesn't really work in old deviations that become comatant over time. And doesn't really work so well in patients who have vertical muscle contracture. So just briefly to go over the three-step test, if you have a right hypertropia, you want to circle the muscles that either pull the right eye down or the left eye up. So that would be the And this is kind of, you're looking at a patient here, so this is the right inferior rectus, right superior oblique, left inferior oblique, or left superior rectus. Then you look at either their gaze right or gaze left, and if it becomes more in their gaze right, then you want to circle the muscles on the patient's right here. And then finally, you assess which side is worse on their head tilt. And if the deviation is worse on their tilt to the left, then you're going to tilt your circles to the patient's left. And this is, again, your patient looking at you. So in this patient, only one muscle circled three times, and that would be the inferior rectus here. So in this case, you would be looking at an isolated paresis of the right inferior rectus. Superior oblique palsy is the most common cycle vertical muscle palsy that we see. Can be congenital or acquired, unilateral, bilateral. Those bilateral cases are often missed because they're can be even straight in primary position. And it's often associated with an abnormal head posture. You can see in some of these kids who come in, if you just review their family albums, you can see that they're always tilted that way. They have an ipsilateral hypertrophia that improves with a contralateral head tilt, and this is often associated with some facial asymmetry. So this kid here has a left superior oblique palsy, and you can see that he's tilting to the right a little bit, and then he also has this side of his face is just a little bit smaller too. We see that pretty commonly in these congenital cases. Skew deviation is a concomitant vertical deviation that's caused by injury to the posterior fossa structures. It's caused by a loss of supranuclear input from the utricle and saccula of the inner ear. Causes an ocular tilt reaction where the eyes rotate toward the lower ear on head tilt, which is different from what we said before on head tilt. You know, when you tilt your head to the right, your right eye should in toward, so it should rotate towards your upper ear, so that's different. In these patients, their deviation doesn't really change when they go on head tilt. They have complementary torsion where their higher eye is intorted, their lower eye is extorted, and it diminishes in the supine position. So you can have them look straight ahead, measure their vertical deviation, then lay them back in the chair, have them look at something on the wall and see and recheck their vertical measurement, and it should decrease. So we look at torsion either objectively or subjectively, and the way we objectively we can't really assess it using external markers. You can't really look at the outside of the eye and see that it's really torted, but we can estimate it when we look inside and look at the fundus. Subjectively, we have the patient kind of tell us how much torsion they think they're seeing. So indirect ophthalmoscopy is a good way to look at anatomic torsion. You can also use fundus photography. The fovea is usually found in the lower third of the optic nerve. This can vary a little bit. And the normal intraocular distance is usually less than a quarter of a disc diameter. So this is an indirect view of the right eye. And you can see that this eye is pretty severely intorted. This is a view we're most used to looking at is indirectly when we see our patients in clinic. Looking at the right eye, you can see that it's really intorted a lot. The fovea should really be up here, this X, but the eye is really severely intorted here. We can assess subjective torsion using either double Maddox rods, where you have the patient's rotate lenses to align them with either the horizontal or the vertical meridian. And you can also use Lancaster red-green testing, which is much more cumbersome to do, but can be more accurate in side gazes and looks at horizontal, vertical, and torsional deviations. Double Maddox rod testing, just a few little tips for doing that. I usually have the patients obliquely orient their lenses at the beginning and then rotate them to get them to, I usually have them align them with the prism, the rods are aligning vertically, but the line they see is horizontally. Sometimes you have to use a base down prism over one eye to because they start fusing the image and making it into one. You can improve this a little bit by darkening the room to eliminate any fusional cues. And what you see is what it is, meaning when you look at them and they've twisted it and they're a little bit out, they are extorted. Some disadvantages of Devomatic's rod testing. It's useful, pretty much only useful in the primary position, and the head position is critical, which could be tough in these patients because they have such a tendency to want to tilt that it's hard to hold their head straight, hold the Fenhoff, and explain to them how to use the little twisters to twist them on. Also, the torsion may localize to the wrong eye. They may localize it to the other eye. Lancaster red-green testing is where we make a diagram of their horizontal, vertical, and torsional deviations and then 9 positions of gaze. We use flashlights to project streaks on a calibrated screen. Here's 2 people performing the test. Actually, this is the woman giving the test. Here's the patient taking the test, wearing the goggles. She shines a flashlight, and he kind of lines up a flashlight with hers. One limitation, they must have normal retinal correspondence for it to work. So here's actually a, I don't know. My other diagram didn't come up here. Oh, here we go. Here's actually a diagram of a Lancaster red-green testing, and you can see that this patient has a right inferior rectus contracture, and she has a large secondary deviation, meaning that when she's fixating with her right eye, the deviation is much greater. You can see that she has a large right hypotropia, this gets worse in down gaze. Gets worse in down gaze. She also has an esotropia that gets worse in down gaze, and a mild to moderate extorsion here. And you can see that it's much better when she's fixating with her left eye. So back to our patient again. She had quite a bit of torsion, just a little bit of deviation in primary gaze. She had more of an ET in down gaze. And just to talk a little bit about bilateral superior oblique palsy, as we've said before, it's easily misdiagnosed, as they may not have a shift in primary position. These patients usually have greater than 10 degrees of X-cycle torsion, which means that they can't fuse it and can be pretty debilitated by it. Commonly associated with an V pattern and a chin down posture to try to put them into a sweet spot. So as far as our surgical treatment options for a patient with bilateral superior oblique palsy, you can consider an inferior oblique weakening, which is really good in cases of unilateral superior oblique palsy, but not usually enough in patients with bilateral superior oblique palsy. You can do an inferior rectus recession, which is the inferior rectus, as you'll recall, is the yolk muscle of the superior oblique. This could be useful in mild cases. Superior oblique tuck, which in our patient would be great because it would solve her torsion, it would help with her V pattern, also help with her incommodance where she has a right hypertropion left gaze and a left hypertropion right gaze. The big risk of this procedure is inducing an iatrogenic Brown syndrome, which is not insignificant. Medial rectus transposition, and you can combine this with a medial rectus recession, is also another possible procedure. This would help with the esotropia, help with the V pattern. When you transpose it, can also help with some of the torsion and the lateral incompetence. Lastly, the Harada Ito procedure, which is a procedure that mostly just concentrates on solving the torsional problems and doesn't so much deal with the horizontal deviation. This patient, actually, we decided to do a Harada Ito procedure. This is where we advance the anterior fibers of the superior oblique muscle. They're the ones that are thought to be more responsible for torsion, whereas the posterior fibers are more responsible for depressing and abducting the eye. So the goal of this procedure is to intort the eye without significantly changing the vertical alignment. And here's actually some pictures I stole from Ken Wright's atlas, where you see you just take that kind of about a third of the superior oblique muscle and move it over to the superior edge of the lateral rectus muscle to really tie it down here to change the vector there, try to intort the eye. These photos don't turn out well at all, but you can see these are the intraoperative photos of the patient, and they show pretty significant fundus extorsion here prior to the Harada Ito, and then after you can see that you can't see, but it's corrected and it looks pretty normal. 2 months after the surgery, she was very pleased. She was now able to walk comfortably without closing one eye. She still did have see some double and extreme down gaze, so it wasn't totally fixed. Here's some pictures of her. You can see that she has a little bit less of that inferior oblique overaction. She doesn't have as much. It doesn't appear in these photos that she has as much lateral incompetence or as much of a V pattern. You can see on her numbers here, she still has some, however. However, she only has a small E, and her ET is less, although she still does have some ET and down gaze, which does still give her some symptoms. So it's kind of your typical strabismus case. We didn't fully solve the problem, but we did make it better. And the big thing here is we flipped her a little bit. She has some in-cycle torsion, but she has much less, and she's able to fuse that. So in summary, torsion can provide important information in cases of vertical strabismus. Even in the absence of torsional complaints, it's an important part of the exam, an important thing to assess both their subjective torsion and their anatomic torsion. We assess anatomic torsion by using indirect ophthalmoscopy. We can assess subjective torsion using either double Maddox rods or Lancaster Green testing. And finally, this is my mentor who gave me some of the pictures that I use. So thanks to him. And any questions? Say it again, sorry. This one here. Is this what you mean? Yeah, it's the superior. It hits the trochlea. Is that what you mean here? Yeah, kind of. This way, it's the superior oblique. So you're just taking about a third of the muscle here and moving it laterally. But this is the superior oblique. I've never heard of them doing it on the inferior oblique at all. And come up, yeah. Particularly a problem in people who fuse.
Yes.
No, she got in a bad she got in a bad MVA, and it was a traumatic bilateral superior oblique palsy.
How long after?
I can't remember how long after. It was, she had stabilized over about six or eight months.
Eight months.
So she had been in the ICU 2 months, and then she had been stable for about 6 months after that. Well, thank you very much. Nice to meet you all.